that gathers your, it's like a hyper-selective group of ultra clinical reasoning nerds. Thank you all. If you can, please, please, please turn on your video. It makes it that much better and so much more fun. I'm curious if anyone has a case they want to present today. I see we have folks from here in the US, folks in Brazil, folks in Germany, folks in India, folks in Egypt. I am multicultural. Yes. Anybody have a case? Nada? Then I guess I can teach you about my yogurt. My yogurt is delicious. It contains strawberries, blueberries, oh, nice. That's true, Ariel. Yes, that's right. Tell us more. I don't know. You haven't been on Global VMR since the OG original appearance, I don't think, at least.
Yes, I have, but you weren't here. Yeah.
I wasn't here? That's impossible. I'm here every Saturday.
Maybe I was on student, but I will be here every day this summer.
Woo! I was like, oh my God, did somebody do Global VMR behind my back? That's the one time I might get angry. Maybe, hypothetically. I don't think I've been angry in a very long time, but hypothetically. Oh, Rafa, you did? How cruel. Okay. Oh, hello. Who is that, Ariel?
This is my niece and nephew. I'm visiting my sister-in-law in Duluth, Minnesota.
Oh, hi, buddies. And what are their names?
So this is Henry. And this is Kelly.
Hi, Harry, Kelly.
She's being shy.
They're very lovely. They're golden retrievers, right? As Robbie.
Yeah.
Yes.
A lot of face kisses.
Yes, they do. Allah is giving you a heart. She is a cat owner who clearly loves dogs. All right, y'all. We can talk about this forever. Anybody have a case? Anybody? Rafa, you have a case? Oh my gosh. No, we can't do that. Can we do that to you? What do you say? Where's your case from? You can unmute. You don't have to talk in the chat. I'm here.
Oh, Robbie, why do you do that? Oh, okay. No, I can. I have a case. I can present one.
From where? Where do you have this case from?
It's actually from the Human Jacks. One that I liked.
Oh, yeah?
It's from a dear friend of ours, actually.
Oh, really? Okay. All right. I'm going to give people an option then because I know they can do the human DX by themselves. So I can give you an option. You all have to vote and you can vote by a thumbs up or nothing. So get your mouse ready for a thumbs up. You have two options. Either we hear about a human DX case from Rafa, which I highly recommend, or I can tell you about a case that
Ravi has one too.
What's that?
Ravi says he has one.
Whoa. Okay. All right. Y'all get to vote. You have one of three options. Thank you for keeping me honest, Ariel. Three options. Three R's too, ironically enough. I can tell you about a case from San Francisco. We can hear about a case from Baltimore, or we can hear the soothing voice of Rafa from Brazil. All right. Hit a thumbs up if you want soothing voice from Brazil. Rafa, you better look closely. Nobody wants to hear Rafa. Yay. My entire life's purpose. Oh, you're getting a sympathy, I think. Thumbs up from Nikita. A sympathy one. I don't know if it's real. Oh, and Shema. Never mind. I think Rafa, you're gonna win this one. All right. Who wants to hear from the annoying and Rafa poking case from me in San Francisco? I'll give you 3 seconds for a thumbs up. One from Ariel. Oh, what? Rafa, you can't do that. No, you have to support your own team. Okay. All right. Four. Five. Okay. All right. I think San Francisco it is. Well, this is unfair, y'all. Okay, fine. I'll tell you a story. That must mean that that Rafa and Ravi are on the hook for the next two Global VMR. Sound good? Okay. This is actually a really, really, really interesting case. It's the case of a 95-year-old veteran who presented with 3 days of fever, headache, and neck pain. I'll stop there and see what thoughts you all have. Gita, please tell us more.
Yeah, I think with this presentation being fever, headache, and neck pain, I'm firstly thinking about it's something to do with an inflammatory process and this a subacute presentation. So the first thing that came to my mind was meningitis, which has a usual presentation like so, but I do know that even a retropharyngeal abscess could possibly cause the same presentation too. So yeah, I think the primary thing that I'm thinking about is disinflammation in general.
Yeah, absolutely superb, beautiful. I couldn't agree more with you. And Shema, tell us more what you're thinking.
So I was basically thinking the same. So we have a time course of 3 days. And as we learned, if we go to through IMAGE, we should prioritize an infective etiology. And together with the headache, I would also rather consider at the moment a secondary headache due to the fever. Yeah, and together with the neck pain, I'm asking myself, is it something like a meningeal irritation? Like something like, I don't know,
meningitis. Yeah, no, I completely agree with you. I think that Leah's agreeing with you too. And Leah, I'm curious, from your experience, what do you think most of these cases end up being of just 3 days of fever? Forget the neck pain part. The neck pain is a little tricky, right? But I'm curious if you can share with us your experience when you take care of somebody who has 3 days of fever. What does it usually, what answers have you found so far?
That's actually an interesting question. I have to say I don't have much clinical experience yet, but when I take out the neck pain, it's just a fever with a headache, and it makes me less worried about things like meningitis. I think the neck pain really puts that into the game. But if with 3 days of fever, I think it's also interesting to know if it's really how high the fever is or if it's a persistent fever, because low-grade fever for 3 days, that could be just a very common infection as well. But I think, especially if it's a 95-year-old, you know, the saying, the older, the colder, I think I'm even more worried if it's a high-grade fever in such an old patient.
Oh, Leah, you said rule number one of medicine, the older you are, the colder you are, meaning that if an older patient is sick enough to mount a fever, that should really grab your attention. It's very unusual. And the younger you are, the warmer you are, which is why a child can have a fever up to 105, right, Shema? Shema's on her pediatrics rotation and has been teaching me so much peds recently. Hey, Christian, I'm really, really curious. Nothing to do with medicine. What are you eating? It looks delicious.
I think you can't see it, but it's a high protein yogurt or pudding. Ooh, that.
A fellow yogurt enthusiast. Cheers, my friend. I just finished mine, so I can't show it to you. It's mine is like mild protein, mostly sugar, but maybe I should change that a little bit. I think there's a lot of wisdom that has gone through the chat. Ariel, tell us more what you're thinking.
I'm just thinking as an older adult, he could be having pain irrelevant of where the inflammation is. So I want to just get more history and, I don't know, physical examination to see if the neck pain is related or not.
100%. Beautiful. Beautiful. I couldn't agree more. And I think Ravi is also reflecting on that. Ravi, do you want to say it out loud?
Yeah, at this juncture, I'm really not sure what to prioritize, but... can't help but think the head and the neck, they're related. So neck pain could radiate and cause headache, or headache could radiate down to the neck. But there's a plethora of structures which could be inflamed and could be infected, or other things could happen to them and could culminate in this sort of presentation. So I'm sort of just listening to the crowd and see what they say.
Yeah, you know, I couldn't agree more. I think that this is why base rate is such an important concept, because it allows you and gives you some immunity to overemphasizing specific findings. So you're protected by always wondering what is the most common cause in the last 100 people from things that may push you to be very granular and hyper-focused. So here, if you ask the question, what is the most common cause of 3 days fever, headache, and neck pain in the last 100 people with this, you would probably come to the observation that a lot of people have chronic neck pain, and their neck pain just gets worse when they're otherwise sick. And so it really becomes a question of, you know, for a fact that this person has 3 days of fever, which goes to the key question in this case is, let's make a list. What are the most common causes of acute infections in older adults? And even if the patient has symptoms not referable to those organs, we should still think about them, because they are way, way, way more common than neck inflammation. So maybe as a group in the chat, we can start to generate that list of what do you all think are the six, let's say, most common reasons why patients get sick enough from an infection to get admitted. So six most common infections resulting in acute hospitalization. What do y'all think? No, you nailed it. Absolutely. So respiratory tract infections are probably number one. Urinary tract infections is coming up a lot. Beautiful. Yeah. So here's the list. In the United States, it's respiratory, GU, general urinary, skin and soft tissue, so cellulitis, unfortunately, hepatobiliary infections, so cholangitis, cholecystitis, enterocolitis, so GI infections like C. diff. And the sixth most common is actually bacteremia without a source. So something like Staph aureus. So in him, no matter what, you have to consider the possibility he has one of those six infections. Skin and soft tissue, respiratory, GU, GI, hepatobiliary, and bacteremia without a source. Ravi, you've come up with a mnemonic. Tell us more.
Yeah, I use it to teach students about most common infectious diseases that are admitted to the hospital. So when they go down to the ER, they're thinking grubs. So exactly like you mentioned, G is GI, all the itises, and more commonly what you mentioned, the enterocolitis, R, respiratory, U, urinary tract infections, complicated more so, B, bacteremia, and S, skin and soft tissue infections. And I did ask somebody in ID if we should elaborate more on this, and they said, yes, why not put C in? So CNS, once you've exhausted the grubs systems. But I guess CNS is not as common if you say the more commonly admitted infections to hospital.
Oh my gosh, I'm totally going to steal this from you. This is so, so good. Thank you. A really, really nice way of capturing the six most common causes. Rafa, I can see you're thinking really hard. What are you thinking about?
No. I'm just to remember this moment, Ravi teaching us that on the
lab. Really? You learned it in real life?
Yes, exactly. Oh, I was fortunate enough for that.
That's so cool. I could see there's some spark going on in your brain. Amazing. I'm also trying to make up for poking you so hard by being nice to you, excessively so now. I owe it. For the next 40 minutes, I'm just going to be so nice to Rafa constantly.
I want a new yogurt by tomorrow in my house. Okay.
You got it. Anything for you. So we're going to have to keep thinking about these things. Let me tell you a crucial piece of information. He, for the last 2 years, has had progressive pancytopenia of unclear etiology. So his white count has been in the 3 range, his hemoglobin has been 9, and his platelets have been in the high 80s. General workup, peripheral workup, so blood, so on and so forth, has been relatively unrevealing, and he's had a working diagnosis of myelodysplasia, or MDS. He declined a bone marrow biopsy owing to his age and saying it, he'd rather live with it than know what it is. 1 year ago, he developed odynophagia, painless swallowing, and developed esophageal candidiasis. I'll stop there. And the general question is, how does this information now influence your analysis of the data we had before? So if you're taking care of this patient and you're hearing this in sequence, what did your mind do? And I'll mute to get your thoughts. Wallace, go ahead, please.
Thank you. So I was thinking that besides the most common bugs that can infect anybody, I think that the fact that this patient is an older adult plus immunodeficiency, we have to look for other sources and we might end up surprised. Like, for instance, this patient can have a severe varicella zoster infection. We can see some findings in his body, and then this could be causing the headache, the neck pain, as some kind of meningoencephalitis, and so on. So we have to, I think that we have to keep our etiology of infections that we're going to this way more broad.
Oh, so good. That's absolutely superb. Marvelous job. Rafa, tell us more what got you to ask that question. Really good question.
Oh, because of the odynophagia, esophageal candidiasis, I can assume that this patient is severe immunosuppressed, at least when it comes to T lymphocytes, and I usually think about HIV. I think it's a very common mistake in medicine. We don't think about HIV in the other patients, but we should.
100%. 5% of new diagnoses of HIV are in people older 65. So it's not rare. And I think that, Rafa, what you just did there is not only did you use the specific details of this case to suspect HIV, but also, in some sense, we should do this exercise to ask, what are the most common reasons an older adult is immunocompromised? So let's practice that. The core schemas of this case will be, what are the 6 most common causes of infection? And remember them as grubs, which is on here on the whiteboard, and we'll review it again later. And now we want to arm ourselves with, what are the most common reasons that older adults are immunocompromised? And HIV is an important one, and I'll mute to get your list, and I'll pull up, in the meantime, pull up a schema. So keep your thoughts coming in the chat. What are the most common causes of immunodeficiency in adults? Beautiful. Vikas, can you unmute and tell us more? Oh, no worries at all. I'll just outline. So Vikas is saying medications, PID, and age. Other things that folks said, common variable immunodeficiency, and Shema said MDS and AML. Nikita, can you elaborate more on what kind of malignancies you think about?
I mean, malignancy in general, I would think about most commonly, like I've seen in practice that a lot of GI malignancies are present in older individuals, but in accordance with this case of pancytopenia, I'm mostly thinking about lymphomas. But also in terms of infection, I would think I would also think that an older individual is more susceptible to opportunistic infections just because of their age and their lower immunity as they age. So those are my few thoughts.
No, I think that's absolutely superb. You're right. The most common reason why patients are immunodeficient as adults, there's three branches to that schema. The first is that they have mild age-related immunosuppression, which explains the incidence of zoster in older adults, amongst other things. One. Two, you already said it. Most common reason for immunodeficiency in older adults is actually a localized anatomic immunodeficiency. Shema taught me that the most common reason kids have kidney disease is from anatomic abnormalities of the urinary tract. This opposite is true of adults who get masses that cause recurrent infections. Most common cause of recurrent pneumonia in an older adult, post-obstructive pneumonia from cancer. A common reason for recurrent cholangitis is pancreatic cancer with a stent, and so on and so forth. So masses block the flow of things, causing recurrent infections. Those first two things are easier to diagnose and more common because they either present with focal infections, so you get the same infection everywhere, not in distant places. And two, age-related immunosuppression is usually pretty mild. If you're invoking a severe, unusual infection in older adults, you have to use the final branch of the schema, which is systemic immunodeficiency in an older adult. And the most common cause of a systemic immunodeficiency in older adults are two things, HIV and medications. But there are many other ones. The theme is end organ disease and heme. So cirrhosis, diabetes, and end-stage renal disease open you up to a variety of immunosuppressive conditions and infections ranging from cryptococcus to mucor to all sorts of things. The hematological organ system gets special mention for things like a common variable immunodeficiency, which is a disease that results from a lack of B cells and a lack of immunoglobulins. Multiple myeloma with resulting hypogammaglobulinemia. And it seems like my dear friend Rafa is becoming a hematology expert because he immediately mentioned both of these things. I'm going to be nice to you for 30 more minutes, bask in it. And after that, it's gone. And splenectomy is very common in older adults for many reasons. And so that can do it. And then MDS, which this patient presumably had, and CLL, chronic lymphocytic leukemia, which we talked about yesterday. Ariel's patient. But this list is actually really easy to extract from the chart. It all actually boils down to medical history, medication reconciliation, and just four lab tests. CBC with differential. This will show you lymphocytosis consistent with CLL. This will show you macrocytosis consistent with MDS. And so you get these two with CBC with diff. You get this with past medical history. Comprehensive medical metabolic panel will get you end-stage renal disease cirrhosis along with diabetes with high sugar, HIV serology. And then if you order serum protein electrophoresis with immunoglobulins, you will get CVID and myeloma. So the most common things are actually captured by routine medical history, medical reconciliation, basic labs, and two other tests that you should get specifically for immunodeficiency, HIV, SPEP with immunoglobulins. That's it. So our investigation for him stopped here. He had esophageal candidiasis, he had progressive pancytopenia, he actually had macrocytosis, and they said, you know what? He likely has MDS. But I just want to arm you, when you're looking for immunodeficiency in an older adult, it's not the same as kids. In kids, you usually have to do a fishing expedition. In older adults, the simple stuff that we do, add an HIV, add an SPEP, and you'll get the majority of it. And I'll leave this for you guys just to take a look at. There's some rare things that can happen in older adults, but definitely don't go here unless you've ruled out this more common stuff. Okay, I'm going to stop to see if any questions popped up in the chat. Okay. All right, y'all. So you go talk to the patient, and I'm going to pretend to be him and tell you a little bit. So I like, hi, sir, nice to meet you. My name is Dr. Robbie. And he's like, hello. And he's standing like this, not moving his neck at all. Like, oh, so what's going on? You know, doc, my head hurts a little bit. And my son told me I had a fever yesterday, but I can't move my neck. No matter what, if I move my neck a little bit, it hurts a lot. Okay, sir, can I try to move your neck? Okay. Screams in pain. And he's sitting like this the whole time. He's alert, interactive, talking to me normally, and he's not moving his neck. I say, how much is your neck hurting right now just sitting there? And he's like, doctor, it's a 10 out of 10 just sitting here. And then if I do this, I would rather be dead. So I'm curious what you make of that. What does that interaction make you think of? Ariel, tell us more. Say your question out loud, please.
I'm just asking. I do not know this. It's from all my understanding from meningitis come from Dr. House. So I have a question that if you can't, oh wow, if you can't move the head up and down, that's more like a meninges inflammation. I don't know about the sideways.
Hello. We have another friend. Hi. I think that's the key question. And I don't have an answer, and I'm curious what other people thought of that. I think you took what I did and distilled it down to, no, it's no big deal at all. If I had to apologize for every time Gnar barks on any CP solver's material, I'd be apologizing forever. So you're good. Okay, I'm going to ask you all to tell me, do you think this is consistent with meningitis, what I just displayed? Because we talk, you know, fever, headache, neck stiffness. Done, right? So do you buy that this is meningitis? And you know, I'm a tricky person. Don't take my body language to tell you that to say no. All right, Nikita, go. I hope you didn't fall for a trap there. Why?
Until now, you haven't really told whether you've examined him in the sense that you have seen for a Koenig sign, per se.
Yeah.
Because this was a very subjective thought being put by the patient, saying that I can't move my neck. So he might have some kind of neck spasm, but I wouldn't truly be sure whether it's meningitis, because not really sure whether neck rigidity is specific for meningitis. It could be any other inflammatory process. It could be, it could probably be a tumor that's not allowing him to do so. I mean, I don't know. I'm just speculating at this point.
And none of us can do anything better than speculating, because this is why we do morning report. There is no literature on this at all. There are nuances with exchanging and getting data from patients that only clinical experience can do. You'll never find any semblance of this in the literature, unfortunately. You just can't capture it in the literature. Let me try to guide you all by asking you one question. The meninges is a covering of the brain from here all the way to the lower back. Why is meningitis reflected in only neck pain? The meninges are here, the meninges are here, and the meninges are in the lower back. Why do we say neck stiffness? Why not back stiffness or head stiffness? Any thoughts on that? Alab, are you able to unmute and tell us that excellent, correct answer?
I was thinking that Zanek is more mobile and moves in every direction. There's more than this one.
Exactly right. Correct. This is the key fact to not make a mistake in this case. Unfortunately, a mistake was made. Meningitis is an irritation of the meninges everywhere, but the neck is the most mobile part. The neck shouldn't hurt any more than any other part at rest. It's rather the fear of movement and discomfort that is most compatible with meningitis. Let me tell you a classic meningitis presentation. Had really bad headache. Photophobia. He didn't have photophobia. Really bad headache. Photophobia. And the neck is fine, but I don't want to move it. I would tell you I have maybe 2 or 3 or 4 discomfort at rest. And then when I move it, 11. Not 10 at rest. And when I move it, 30. The amount of pain he had at rest, especially in the absence of photophobia, especially given the fact that his story was all about neck, 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 neck. This is why we talk about the chief concern, to allow the patient to triage what they are most worried about. A patient with a lot of abdominal pain and a little diarrhea is very different than a patient with a lot of diarrhea and a little abdominal pain. Very different. A patient with fever and fever headache and a little neck stiffness is very different than a patient with neck, neck, neck and a little fever and a little headache. Very different. The amount of ingredient of each concern significantly changes the diagnostic considerations. It doesn't change what you do, because this is an older adult who's immunosuppressed, who even an atypical presentation of meningitis needs evaluation, but you look at him and you're like, I need to do more than just a lumbar puncture. So now that we've had this conversation, I'm curious what your next steps would be. So you're taking care of this patient. I will give you a full exam, so you don't need to think about that. I will give you a usual set of labs, so you don't have to think about that. But what measures do you want beyond exam and labs for this patient? And I'll mute and give you whatever you need. All right, beautiful, Rafa. So great, no neurological deficits. Keep your questions coming. Oh, superb. Dental exam, nothing, normal. Past medical history, thankfully, Nikita, he had nothing else except that MDS. Ravi, can you share more your pursuing of the HNT exam?
I think the description, that was very interesting when you mentioned about, it really didn't deeply reflect about meningitis and Ala brought up a great point about the neck being mobile, but then I'm trying to, I don't know why I'm fixated in the anterior neck compartment rather than the posterior, and from the experience where I've seen patients have extreme pain would be somewhere around the oropharyngeal region. Somebody had mentioned a retropharyngeal abscess. That could be a cause as well, but tonsillar, I guess, infection or involvement can extend, or peritonsillar abscess, or even infection of the floor of the mouth, so something like Lemierre syndrome, or what's the other one that you have? I guess the septic thrombophlebitis of the
Lemierre.
Internal jugular.
Yeah, nailed it. I love that. I think that's such an important consideration for mysterious neck pain. Thankfully, he had no oral symptoms, and a quick glance in his oropharynx was normal. Ariel wants a neck x-ray, which I will give you in a moment. Let me just answer the history questions. So Leah, he had no trauma, but I really, really, really would love to know what hypothesis you were pursuing there. I think it is really important in this case.
I think I'm just asking about if there was some kind of event that we couldn't deduce just by clinical reasoning, maybe something he hasn't told us yet. So to exclude trauma kind of, and then also if there's maybe a hematoma or something that's growing or compressive, or even than having like kind of local compression of something else that might cause pain, or if there's a fracture in a way. Those were the thoughts I had.
Absolutely superb. I think that's that is very, very wise. Thankfully, he had no history of trauma that he could recall. And Nahida, he's local and lives in Northern California. And has no other neurological symptoms, Ariel. Okay, let me tell you. So the rest of the exam, he's completely normal. His labs, as expected, his baseline pancytopenia has not changed at all. His renal panel is normal. His liver enzymes are normal. His HIV is negative. And a CT head done before an LP was normal. And his lumbar puncture, normal. No pleocytosis, nothing. Completely normal. What do you want to do? And I should say, the infection workup, chest x-ray negative, UA negative, no rash, liver enzymes normal, blood cultures pending, negative. Beautiful. All right. Dr. Singh, master in action. ESR very high, over 100. CRP over 150. Oh, and Nikita, everything on exam was normal. No lymphadenopathy, nothing. Completely normal. GCA. Ravi, can I ask you, what prompted that thought? Like, what data points did your mind use to generate that thought?
I don't know. It's just a thought. You gave an extensive amount of data, which was exhaustive and negative. So then you're like, where should we focus our attention? And then, you know, what's interesting? You know, remember our friends from Ireland?
Yes, of course. The
Global VMR. So it is a Global VMR today. Wow. So I sat in on their case Thursday morning at 3 a.m.
Yeah,
I was up 3 a.m. But guess what? The CRP had a role in that case. I won't. I may have them come and present their case. It was really, I was blown away. It was a great case.
Wow.
So it's like deja vu, or it's like recency bias. It's like, the sed rate was high in that case, maybe inflammation. So I'm like, okay, the white count's normal, maybe let's look at that. And if that's elevated, but then you said it was elevated and then immediately knee-jerk reaction, GCA, and that can be very painful as well.
100%. As a challenge question to you all, how can you further augment Ravi's hypothesis of GCA by answering, why would the patient have neck pain with GCA? What do you all think? What explains, white count is normal. That's all normal. Shema, educate us, please.
So as we know, for giant cell arteritis, it is also like in 50% of the cases, I think, associated with polymyalgia rheumatica. So we have usually this proximal pain in here. That's why this came into my thought.
Absolutely superb. Spot on. I can see that I've bambled a bit. So a long, long time ago, about 3 years ago now, we really set out to try to put out schemas, and normalize the concept of a schema. So let me share with you a schema, and I will put it up here for fever and neck pain. And we'll see what thoughts it generates. And the next part will be, you're literally there taking care of this patient in the emergency room still. All this happened in the first few hours, basic lab. What would you do next? So hopefully the schema can give you some ideas. I'm just going to silently leave it here and just remind you of some things. He had no lymphadenopathy. His TSH was normal. He had no palpable lesions around his carotid or his IJ. He had a normal oral exam. And he had a normal LP. So please, please, please try to push yourself to be that clinician taking care of him, and put down what you think you might do as next steps. Because too often in VMR, we talk about what the answer is. So let's practice. What is your next step? Beautiful, Wallace. His thrombocytopenia is 50, 55. Wallace is wondering if he might have a hematoma, a spontaneous hematoma from his thrombocytopenia. Excellent. All right. Keep trying to practice. What's your next move in the ER? There's no wrong answer. Very hard case, right? So Leah is wondering, should, now that we've made infection less likely, should our next move be empiric steroids? Always something in your back pocket for sure. Keep your thoughts coming. Yeah, steroids is a diagnostic test. Beautiful. All right. I'm going to ask all of you who said something already, anything that you want to do. So Shema, what would you want to do?
I would also do a test of the steroids because I'm still thinking of the same.
Beautiful. Ariel, what's your instinct telling you?
I'm still entertaining the small possibility of a tick-borne disease. I know it can cause pancytopenia as beautiful. Well as meningitis. It's not meningitis, but like CNS type of inflammation.
Beautiful. I think you can't miss that in a febrile pancytopenia. And so you probably, if that were high on your list, I think the moves that you have are tick-borne testing, which is complicated, or empiric doxycycline, which is a great medication for many tick-borne diseases. Wallace already said neck imaging in the chat. Nikita said neck imaging in the chat. I'll come back to you guys in a second. Leah offered the idea of empiric steroids. Christian, I think you count because you told us about your yogurt. So you did say something. What would you want to do?
I would like to have an MRI, I guess, for the neck. And then maybe the steroids.
Beautiful. That's a great segue into the next part of the conversation is neck imaging. And I'll just share my thoughts. It's always a little bit tricky to decide to get a CT or an MRI. Chest x-rays of the neck are helpful in areas where you don't have access to CT or MRI, but unfortunately, they're very, very limited diagnostic utility. So in trying to decide between CT and MRI is actually not an easy decision. MRI takes longer and is a very, very sensitive test for everything. But it has one major problem as a test. It is too sensitive. Sometimes the MRI will overcall bony diseases. And if you're looking at just the bone alone, and this is for my dear friend Nahida and her future orthopedic career, she will likely ask for many CTs, many, 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 because CT visualizes the bone much better than MRI. MRI is a helpful test when you're thinking of a bone problem that is CT negative. And so you're using its increased sensitivity to detect occult bony disease. But if you have an overt bony disease that will show up on CT, MRI often overcalls the severity and significance of that disease, and sometimes can call fractures when there aren't any fractures, as an example. It exaggerates the findings. So use it when you think there's a finding, but it doesn't show up on CT. Try to avoid it when you worry that your finding is overt and MRI might exaggerate its significance. It's the problem of overly sensitive tests. They become so sensitive that they even see the dust on the camera, which is completely irrelevant to what you're trying to do. So with that in mind, we obtained a CT scan. Exactly, Allah. You're full of analogies like PCR. I love it. And so his CT, it shows large penis formation at C1 and C2, confirming the diagnosis. Boom. Leah, tell us. You're right. Correct.
So this is actually really funny because I think I just did a case today that had the same diagnosis. And I hadn't heard about it before, but it's a version of pseudo gout that manifests at the ligament, the transverse ligament, because it's one of the fibrous cartilage kind of ligaments that it likes to deposit. And it actually is a great mimicker of bacterial meningitis or infectious meningitis, because it has the leukocytosis fever and this neck pain kind of symptoms. So yeah, that's why I thought of this.
Absolutely superb. You hit the nail on the head. This is a very common presentation of a common disease, but probably highly underrecognized, because many patients get NSAIDs for their neck pain, NOS, and NSAIDs are a treatment for Crown-Den syndrome. So what is it? As you said, it is an acute CPBD arthropathy of the neck. CPBD or pseudogout is a common disease, only secondary to gout, as a crystalline disease causing acute monoarticular arthritis. It usually affects the wrists, the ankles, and the knee, but in a substantial portion of patients affects their neck. And the diagnosis is very tricky. It's very hard. It requires excluding other causes of fever plus neck pain and characteristic imaging findings at C1 and C2. Let me tell you what happened to this patient. He got one dose of prednisone 20, and the next day he left the hospital. He was that good. He went from, oh my God, you're going to have a severe case of meningitis, to leaving one day and going home on a prednisone taper. Happily ever after. It was amazing. Eye-opening experience. So I think this case is a humble reminder of four things. Crubs every single time. G-R-U-B-S, every single time. When somebody's immunosuppressed, remember that the most common causes can be acquired and analyzed very simply through medical history, medication reconciliation, basic labs, HIV, SPEP. But when somebody emphasizes their neck pain over their other symptoms, especially if their neck pain is prominent at rest, you should still pursue meningitis because it is deadly, but you should be prepared for the next step, anticipating negative LP results. So it doesn't change your management. It just means that you should probably already order the CT or MRI of the neck as soon as the LP results are back, basically. And the fourth, I would say, is what Leah just demonstrated. Is nothing can replace the power of practice and exposure that all of you are doing by showing up on a Saturday here in Virtual Morning Report. So thank you for hanging out, for learning together. And all of you are going to be better caretakers of your patients for having gone through this, investing this hour of your time. I appreciate it. But unfortunately, none of you will grow as much as I do, because I get to hang out with you and teach you all. And there's nothing that helps anybody grow than teaching. So I hope one day you will have the opportunity to teach, because there's nothing like it, honestly. So thank you for helping me grow as well. I'll mute for a little bit to see what questions come in the chat. And then we'll pass the mic to Shema for teaching points. Nikita, did I think of infection? Of course. So there was nothing that was going to dissuade a febrile older adult from thinking infection. But I've seen this Crown-Den syndrome now maybe 4 or 5 times. So the first time I saw it, I didn't even know it existed, and I got lucky. I actually forget how I arrived at the diagnosis. It wasn't just me. But this time I've seen it enough that I suspected it. And I thought, you know what, we have to do this, but I'm hopeful that I'm hopeful that he'll have Crohn-Den syndrome and not meningitis. But this doesn't mean that you can't do an LP. It just means that you should adjust your pretest probability of meningitis lower. It will never be low enough to avoid an LP in somebody who's immunosuppressed, but low enough that you should start to think, what's next? Usually with a case of meningitis, what's next is antibiotics and good luck. But in this patient, what's next is CT. Yes, Leah. So the neck pain is usually very prominent. Think about it. It's basically gout of your neck. You know how painful gout is? If you've ever seen somebody or will see somebody, oh my God, it's excruciating. So it is a big tip off for this diagnosis is a disproportionate representation of the patient by the severity of the neck. It is excruciating. And how quickly it melts away with anti-inflammatory therapy is amazing. He went from 30 out of 10 pain to I'm leaving with one dose of prednisone, one. I love it, Robbie. Podagra of the neck. You're amazing with these play on words. I love it. Yeah, all of the cases were neck predominant. Yep. All right, y'all. Shema, take us home, please.
So, Robbie, thank you so much for this great case. I'm trying to see you all. Wait. Okay. First of all, thank you so much for this very great discussion. I learned so much. So, starting with some quick teaching points. So, we had as a chief complaint acute fever and headache in an old person. We go through the IMAID schema due to the acute symptomatic. We're prioritizing infection. And then we were talking about the most common infections in older adults resulting in hospitalization. We're collecting six things, but we also added one. So, think of respiratory, GU, gastrointestinal like enterocolitis, skin and soft tissue, hepatobiliary things like cholecystitis, and also about bacteremia without a source, and also think of CNS. And then also think of the pearl, like Leah mentioned, the older, the colder. So if we have fever in an old person, it's always concerning. And then also the thing of neck pain and also headache, the key question, could neck pain lead to headache or vice versa? And then the most common reasons for immunocompromised states in older persons, the most common are HIV and medications, but also think of mildly age-related things leading to zoster. Think of end organ diseases like diabetes, end-stage renal disease, cirrhosis, and also about hematologic complications like myeloma, splenectomy, and malignancies like hematologic malignancies like CLL and macrocytosis. And if we do some tests for it, like if we do a complete blood count with differential, we would expect a lymphocytosis hinting for CLL and a macrocytosis hinting for MDS together with pancytopenia, as we know, and also perform SPAP with IGs to consider things like myeloma or CVID. And then what we also learned about the chief complaint of neck pain, we were thinking of meningitis, what we also learned is always think of the amount of the pain. Like if we overcall the neck pain, we should think of something else. And then thinking of the differentials for neck pain that I also collected. So we have infective agents, also trauma, and also any compression, thinking of any hematoma, is there any malignancy, any metastasy, and also think of rheumatic things. We were thinking of giant cell arteritis, which is also very often associated with polymyalgia rheumatica. And then Robbie demonstrated the great schema of fever and neck pain. And if it's like in the anterior, think of lymphadenopathy, thyroid disease, a vascular disease, and in the posterior area, think of soft tissue masses of the meninges and also the vertebra, as we had in this case, CPPD, so calcium pyrophosphate, something like a pseudo gout in the in the C1, C2 area presenting, leading to neck pain. So as I also read now, it's the chameleon of acute, not back pain, neck pain. Sorry that I wrote it here. So it's basically a gout of the neck. Yeah. And the last product I want to mention, it's about the neck imaging. So basically we perform MRI if the CT scan of the bone is occult. So because the thing with MRI is, the problem is it's too sensitive and it can overcall a bony disease. Yeah, so I stop here. I thank you all so much for the great discussion and the teaching. Yeah.
Incredible job, Jamie. That was absolutely superb. Thank you all for hanging out. It was a real treat and hope to see you on the next VMR. Bye.